Friends, I've just been told that I should be speaking on the debacle that overtook the Congress and its resurrection. Well, Jesus Christ took 3 days to be resurrected. I think the resurrection of the Congress has started after 3 months. For if I had had to make this visit to you even last week, I think I'd have been in a much more disadvantageous position than I am today. It's not that the Congress has done particularly well in the few by-polls that we had over the weekend, as it were. But that in a state like Gujarat, where we have been consistently losing to the point where we've been completely wiped out, to return with even a couple of seats is in percentage terms to make an infinite percentage recovery from zero to something. And in Rajasthan, we were first almost wiped out in the assembly polls, and then actually wiped out in the Lok Sabha polls. And that's about 100 days ago. And today, to have won so many seats, to have swept the board as it were, although it's a very small board, is, I think, a demonstration of an inner resilience that any well-established old party is bound to have, otherwise it couldn't be well established at all. The other way I can think of comforting myself is that at 44 seats, the Congress party has 22 times more seats than the BJP had in the Lok Sabha in 1984. So if the BJP, which even got its name only in 1982, can make it from 44 to 282, or sorry, from 2 to 282. Well, the Congress should be able to make it from 44 to 440. And don't forget, we've had 440 in the past. So to take a snapshot view of what the Congress looked like on the 16th of May 2014, and project it as the eternal future condition of the party shows you to be an idiot or belonging to the BJP, which is perhaps the same. The fact is that in 129 years, the Congress has known a huge number of downs, apart from the few ups that it has had. The downs began, I think, towards the end of the 19th century and into the first decade of the 20th, when a split arose between factions that were eventually led by Lal Bal and Pal on the one hand, and by reasonable human beings like Gokhale on the other. And we survived that split. We then survived the cataclysmic change that came to the Congress in 1919, after Jallianwala Bagh, when Gandhi suddenly burst upon the scene and told a party of aristocrats and bourgeois lawyers that the drawing room is not the place where we are going to get the independence of India. You have to be out on the streets, and to prove your credentials, you first have to burn all the clothes that you bought on Savile Row. They did it. There was one man who didn't. He warned Gandhi, "You're mixing religion with politics, and you are taking to the street what you will not be able to control once it reaches the street." His name was Muhammad Ali Jinnah. And there were two occasions on which Jinnah was known to cry. One was later when his wife died, and the other was as he sat in the train in Nagpur in 1920, seeing that his hopes for the party had been taken over by a curious revolutionary who didn't seem to know whether he was a saint or a politician. And as he sat in the car, in the train, prior to the end of the Congress session, returning early to Mumbai, somebody claims that he saw him brushing a tear from his eye. So that was a time when the Congress could have been completely finished. But instead, it got an injection of a new life It was literally resurrected. And resurrected to the point where you could perhaps not tell the difference between Jesus Christ and his Father. But what happened 2 years later? 2 years later, Chauri Chaura took place, and simultaneously, or more or less simultaneously, the Turkish Empire was overthrown and the Khilafat was rejected. And therefore the rationale of the Khilafat movement, which was at the heart of the first non-cooperation Satyagraha, also was taken away. And so in many ways, the reason for which the Congress Party departed from the Jinnah route and took on the Gandhi route had to be abandoned. Gandhi himself presided over the 1924 Belgaum conference, but found that he had no influence left on the party. And therefore he retired to Sabarmati to do what he always did when he was not running the Congress, which was to check on the state of his intestines. His obsession with digestion is something that comes through in all his writings at about that time. He was either into carrot juice or he was into enemas, but there was very little of politics in what he was doing. And he seemed to be quite certain in his mind that he was quitting. And he was quitting for two major reasons. One was that the Congress was being forced to repudiate what it had regarded as its single biggest achievement in the 20th century, which was getting the Muslim League on board as a partner in the freedom movement by accepting separate electorates. But the acceptance of separate electorates in 1916 led to competitive communal politics in the 1920s, making the 20s the real year of the divide between the Hindus and the Muslims, in a way which we were never able to overcome. It was also the year in which several prominent members of the Congress Party, led by Chittaranjan Das, but including people like Motilal Nehru, set up the faction within the Congress that said they would contest the Central Assembly elections, and went into the Central Assembly and tried to behave like British parliamentarians in the Indian version of Westminster. So you have a period from certainly beginning in 1922, but going apace from 1924, which in 1927 reaches another watershed. Now what was that? It was the decline of the Congress. And Jawaharlal Nehru took himself off to Europe in 1927 and was away for most of that year. In the meanwhile, the Brits had decided to have the Simon Commission come out to India to write up the next stage of the constitutional evolution of India. And because they didn't contain a single Indian member, Gandhi and the Congress generally decided to boycott the Simon Mission and instead set up a committee with Motilal Nehru at its head, who were to write the alternative Indian version of the Simon Commission's constitution. And in the course of that in 1927, there were two major developments which were going to affect the future of the Congress and the future of the nation. The two of which, certainly at about that time, were more or less coterminous, India and the Congress. One was that a Delhi Pact was signed between Motilal Nehru, Tej Bahadur Sapru, and M.A. Jinnah, in which M.A. Jinnah repudiated his greatest achievement, separate electorates. He accepted the idea of joint electorates, saying that separate electorates had, contrary to expectation, led to communalism, and asked principally for four things. Number one, he wanted Sindh separated from Bombay, which to us today seems such an obvious thing to do, as there was a distance of 800 miles by sea from Bombay to Karachi, and there was no other means of communication. The separation of Sindh from Bombay. Secondly, the grant of governor's status to governor status rather than lieutenant governor status to the Northwest Frontier Province. Third, a proportional representation for Muslims in the Indian Army. And fourth, 33% reservations for Muslims in the central legislature. And in exchange for that, we were going to get rid of separate electorates. We can't think of a more sensible thing to do. At the same time, Motilal Nehru and his friends came to the conclusion that what we needed was dominion status, that there was so much that was to the benefit of India in the empire, that provided we became a self-governing dominion, like Canada or Australia, but what was the problem in accepting King George V as the Emperor of India? Nehru seems to have had some information that this was going on. And he wrote to Gandhi a letter that you can find partially referred to in Biyananda's book on Nehru, but where even Biyananda doesn't seem to have understood its real significance, which was Gandhi writing back to Nehru in Europe, saying that I've lost my influence in the Congress, nobody listens to me. So when Nehru returned in about November or December of 1927 to attend the Madras session of the Congress, at which his father, Motilal, was due to be elected the president of the Congress, he blew his top, saying he didn't accept dominion status. And his language was so extreme that the opposition to the father was led by the son. That was the extent of the crisis within the party. And as for the 33% recommendation, they were not parallel recommendations with regard to those provinces of India where the Muslims were in the majority. And so the leaders of the Punjab, that is the United Punjab, stretching from Attock all the way to Palwal, that Punjab, the Hindu and the Sikh leaders, said nothing doing unless we get something similar in Punjab. And there, it was 49-51, a bit like in Scotland. And so the Muslims there, led by Fazle Haslam, said absolutely nothing. Them and Sir Muhammad Shafi, that under no circumstances will we agree to similar concessions being made for the Muslim areas. And Fazlul Haq, as usual, was fuzzling the things. And he took an uncertain stand. And so some of the Hindu leaders of the Congress, including Sharad Chandra Bose and people like that, were ambiguous in their response. They were not willing to accept the 33% formula. So these were the two major events that were taking place in the life of the Congress in the year 1928. And Nehru's voice got shriller and shriller and shriller. Jawaharlal's voice became shriller and shriller and shriller, to the point that when the 1928 Congress session of the Congress was to take place, Calcutta session of the Congress was to take place, Motilal went to Mahatma Gandhi and pleaded with him to come and be present at the Kolkata session, saying, "You're the only one who can rein in my son. He only listens to you and then behaves properly, otherwise I don't know what is the language he's going to use against me." And Gandhi agreed, but in his usual way, with a condition. And the condition was that instead of electing the next president of the Congress, he would nominate him. In the meanwhile, Jinnah had succeeded in doing in 1928 what he had been instrumental in doing in 1916, which was to have the Muslim League session held in the same city at the same time. So in Kolkata, simultaneously, as in Lucknow in 1916, we had the two sessions of the two parties. And when those two parties had this session, then the definitive break began, because people like Fazle Hasan, but perhaps more important, Muhammad Shafi, demonstrating their total disdain of the Congress, said that they opposed the opposition to the 33% formula. And Rajmohan Gandhi, in his brilliant book called Understanding the Muslim Mind, portrays Muhammad Ali Johar, who was Gandhi's right hand in the non-cooperation satyagraha 1921-22. Combining, says Rajmohan, his two favorite prejudices in a single sentence, said of Gandhi, "You are a Baniya, you are a Jew," when refusing this 33% and insisting that it will be no more than 27%. Can you imagine? 6% was the difference which brought about Pakistan and all the horrors of that partition. An argument over 6%. And it was led by people like Lala Lajpat Rai and Madan Mohan Malviya. And we didn't have a proper BJP at that time to throw the Congress detritus into. So they were all part of the Congress. And this was all an intra-Congress discussion. And so the Nehru Pact was repudiated. Gandhi's compromise was that he was going to take 1 year, the whole of 1929, in order to negotiate a deal with his friend Lord Irwin, and that thereby he would postpone the declaration of Purna Swaraj. And it was only in Lahore, at the end of 1929 and into the beginning of 1930, that Jawaharlal Nehru was given his head and said, "Right, you go ahead and you declare the Republic of Wales. You declare Purna Swaraj," and that day, the 26th of January, became 20 years later our Republic Day. So here is an example of a party collapsing and then rising. And then, I don't want to go into such detail for the future, but we had a major resurrection when the 1937 elections took place. And the Muslim League, in separate electorates, got only less than 5% of the total Muslim vote, which led Jawaharlal into the miscalculation that Jinnah did not represent the Muslim League, and firmed up Jinnah's opinion that all his efforts at leading to a united secular India had failed on the rocks of Hindu obstinacy, and he became a more communal leader of the Muslims than most Muslim Maulanas were. Indeed, the Muslim Maulanas had their grave doubts. For theocratic reasons, Maulana come back to me in a minute, the man who ultimately formed the Jamaat-e-Islami in Pakistan, he was the one who opposed the partition of India on the grounds that you can't divide the Muslim community. And the Devband Ulama were always against the partition of India. So more than the mullahs, it was a so-called secular politician, Jinnah, who, seeing Jawaharlal Nehru's sneer, decided that the object of his life was to defeat Jawaharlal, even if it meant dividing the country and then attempting to run a pale version of Nehruvian India in Pakistan. These are the ironies of history. But that 1937 victory was a Pyrrhic victory, because the governments that were formed by the Congress very soon came to be dubbed corrupt and communal, with the result that the Muslim League was back in business within a couple of years. We were back in business in 3 months, so don't feel too upset about that. The Muslim League were back in business, and then you couldn't stop them. And within 8 years of being back in business, they came into power. And how did they come into power? Because when the Congress decided to walk out of the provincial ministries, Jinnah immediately walked in and said that he's going to help. And that established such a strong bond between him and Linlithgow, Gore, which got carried on to Wavell, that Pakistan became inevitable. While our leaders, thinking that they had run a great movement in the Quit India movement, found themselves imprisoned and therefore unable to influence things. And in the meanwhile, the freedom movement, such as it was, went into the hands of violent people and completely against the principles of Mahatma Gandhi. Yet and all, when the last phase of the freedom struggle came at the end of the Second World War, the Congress was still able to emerge as the voice of much of India, although it didn't know that it had lost a substantial proportion of that voice, and that there was a competitor, at least in the Muslim segment, for its claim to be the voice of all Indians. And in the meanwhile, the extremist element, led by Savarkar, who had become president of the Hindu Mahasabha, picked up Jinnah's theories and turned them on their head. I have seen a newspaper report of the 15th of August 1943, which is ironically 4 years to the day that we were going to be independent, where Savarkar says he agrees with Jinnah's two-nation theory, that the Muslims and the Hindus do constitute two separate nations. And it is because of that philosophy that there arose this man, Nazirullah Bhagwanse, who eventually carved his niche in history by assassinating Mahatma Gandhi. So we've had these ups and we've had these downs. More recently, after independence, we had the Purushottam Das Tandon revolt in 1950, where it looked as if the Congress Party was going to don the BJP's mantle. And if it wasn't for the fact that Sardar Patel was no longer on the scene after December 1950, and that Nehru had got control of the party and showed himself to be as much a politician as a statesman, that he wrested the Congress back from the hands of people like Purushottam Das Tandon and into the secular hands, which were led by him. And it was just in that context, on the 2nd of October 1951, that on Gandhi Jayanti Day, he went to the Ramlila grounds to address a mass meeting and delivered himself with the one sentence for which I think we should celebrate Nehru forever and forever and forever. He defined secularism as a governmental activity. In that, his definition was the following. He said, and I want you to listen to this very carefully, if any man raises his hand against another in the name of religion, I shall fight him till the last breath of my life from within the government and from outside. Now, if you parse that sentence, if any man raises his hand against another, for what? In the name of religion. There are many reasons why a man may raise his hand against another, but he specifically isolates what would happen in the case of this being in the name of religion. He says, I shall fight him. This is a non-violent man, but he's willing to go to any length to fight communism. I shall fight him, and this becomes clear by his next phrase, till the last breath of my life. Does he mean the breath that will be taken away, or does he mean the natural death? In either case, it means that this is a lifelong struggle. Till the last breath of my life, whether from within the government as Prime Minister or from outside, he's envisaging the possibility of his no longer being the Prime Minister of India. And based upon that, we had a secular India for the better part of the next 32 years. And that was a period of huge triumph for the Congress until 1975, when Mrs. Gandhi declared the emergency because effectively she lost control. And then she got her just desserts in 1977. And then those who replaced her, and that was a much lower point than now. It was a rejection specifically of the leader. I remember that day I was posted in Baghdad, and I was delighted that she'd been deleted. But I didn't want to share it because my ambassador was pro-Indira Gandhi. So when I arrived at this dinner party that evening, having picked up on the way the information that both she had lost and her son had lost, I had to share it with somebody. And fortunately, the chief guest of that dinner was a Tamilian. So I said to him in Tamil that the cow is gone and so is the calf. That was the spirit in which it was. My brother wrote to me that he was a Fleet Street man, he was a Bahadur Shah. And in those days, there was no television and instant news and so forth. So they were putting up the results on the board. And he said that some Sardarji went and bought 30 or 40 chickens from Moti Mahal, and he was holding them and he said, Lagao, batao, bolo, that you know Indira Gandhi has lost, because he's just waiting to distribute these chickens to everybody. That was an experience you'll never have, and I'll always regret it for you. It was a moment of liberation. it felt like Subodha, that we had really come free again. And yet, how long did that euphoria last? Within just a couple of years, it was, well, actually within a few months it was over. And within a couple of years, it was definitively over. And she bounced back. And not only did she bounce back, but it seemed immediately after she bounced back that she was going down again. Because there were elections coming up in Karnataka and in Andhra Pradesh, both of which were fortresses of the Congress, and we lost in both. One to NTR and one to Ramakrishna Hegde. So it went down again. And then she was assassinated. Rajiv was expected to continue ruling as long as he could without an election. To everyone's astonishment, he declared an election within about two weeks of his coming as a nominated prime minister. And that election he won with more than 400 votes. And it looked as if the future of the country for the next generation had been settled. But in a democracy, nothing is settled for that long. 25 days is quite a long time to have things settled for. And so he began losing by-elections and provincial elections, state assembly elections. And we all know that at the end of 1989, he had been reduced from 400 plus seats. I've forgotten the exact figure. I think it was about 422 or 23, something like that, to 192. That is, it was a fall comparable to the fall from 206 seats to 44 seats in percentage terms. And yet, can you say the Congress got finished? They recovered. I think Rajiv would have become Prime Minister again in 91. In any case, the Congress came back with help from others. Then we lost out in 96. We acquired for ourselves an Italian leader, and people were going around polishing their Italian accents. And Sushma Swaraj was stroking her long black locks and saying that if an Italian becomes Prime Minister of India, I'm going to shave all these beautiful locks of mine. What happened? The Congress won a totally unexpected victory in 2004 with no more than about 140 seats. And in the next elections in 2009, we went up by about 65 seats under Manmohan Singh. In 2009, you're all giggling, but it's the truth. It was under Dr. Manmohan Singh, and largely because Advani took him on as a weak prime minister. Then the country said, nothing doing, he's a strong prime minister. Gave him 65 seats more. Now giggle all you want. Giggle all you want. The fact of the matter is that in 2009, there was a resurrection that put Jesus Christ to shame. And the tables then turned. But in the short history of the Congress that I've given you, how many times have the tables turned? Well, I can't count, but I just say again and again and again. And then we come around again. So this is like a roundabout. Sometimes we pass by the guy who's sold you the ticket, and sometimes we are at the other end of the diameter. But the roundabout continues and we come back. So anybody who thinks that the Congress was finished in May 2014 is living in a world of illusion. And the BJP and all its supporters, and don't forget that's a huge proportion of the country, all of them were celebrating not the birth of the BJP so much as the death of the Congress. When? I'm not talking prehistory, I'm not talking Jurassic Park. I'm talking 100 days ago. 100 days ago, you were all convinced that Earth was khatam ho gaya. And where then I said the cow is gone and the calf also, you thought that the mother is gone and the son also. Well, I'm sorry, we're still here. We're still here. We are the largest party in the Rajya Sabha. And it looks as if we're going to keep it that way. Because if a set of three bipoles keeps on giving anti-BJP results, whomever it's pro, At least it's not the BJP that is going to come in from those states into the Rajya Sabha to provide present reckoning. Now, if things can change for us, well, things can change for them too. So the mere fact that three sets of bipoles have gone against them doesn't prove that Maharashtra and Haryana will go against them. I'm not a betting man, but I am a drinking man. So what about a bottle of whiskey? And I don't get it duty-free anymore. So what about a bottle of whiskey as to who's going to be beaten in Haryana and Maharashtra? I don't know who's going to win. But it seems to me that in Maharashtra, the BJP is bound to be beaten for two reasons. Number one, the Shiv Sena is going to demand its pound of flesh in a much louder manner than they've been doing so far. And already, they have been saying that the BJP's lust is going to lead to divorce, which led me to remark that it's usually the lack of lust that leads to divorce. That's a separate matter. The lust is going to lead to a divorce. Well, now the terms of the divorce settlement are going to be even more attractive. So I see the Shiv Sena insisting that should they come to power, it's they who should take the chief ministership, not the BJP, which in itself would be a setback for the BJP. And secondly, that if they are being beaten in Uttar Pradesh by characters like Yogi Adityanath, then the Shiv Sena is crawling with these creatures. Love, jihad, 99% of rapists are Muslims, madrasas are the breeding ground of terror. I'm not quoting myself, my love. I'm telling you what Yogi Adityanath and somebody called Sakshi Maharaj, Sakshat idiot is what we say. These characters are going to look like the most reasonable human beings, which is why we have the comical spectacle of Chandan Mitra, who I dare say is going to be called in this gallimaufry of politicians who's coming to address this group. One day you'll call him, and he'll do before you the act that he did yesterday on Karan Thapar's show, where he said that the results were not up to our expectations, but we don't regard it as a setback. Now, I don't know which dictionary he's got, but in my mind, if you don't meet your expectations, that is a setback. Anyway, it's for them to comfort themselves as best as they do, and it's not for me to provide them with a handy to wipe away their tears. The fact is, we've done hardly anything. Just a little recovery. But Jesus Christ only showed himself and disappeared. And they call it a resurrection. The entire Christian religion is based upon the fact that one, his was a virgin birth. And secondly, that he was seen on the third day, but not on the fourth day. And yet that's enough to set up an ideology. And the reference to the virgin birth makes me want to share with you, although it has nothing to do with this lecture, in view of the fact that I'm going to Australia, my favorite Australian joke, which is, why was Jesus Christ not born in Australia? And the answer is, where in Australia can you find three wise men and a virgin? So that's the problem. So here we have a situation where there is a definite setback for the BJP, whatever, however they want to disguise it. And any setback for the BJP is a gain for us. Why do I say that? Because in 2004, the Congress did not win the elections. In 2004, the Congress put together a coalition of dissidents. Everyone who didn't like Vajpayee came and joined us. By 2014, everyone who didn't like us had left us. And therefore, our victory in 2004 was the consequence of our playing the coalition game successfully. And our defeat in 2014 is the result of our not playing the coalition game successfully. I know that Dr. Manmohan Singh and P. Chidambaram and Kapil Sibal, made a notable contribution to our defeat. But nothing that they did or didn't do could possibly have brought us down to 44 seats if everybody hadn't abandoned us. And one by one they did. We are in such big difficulty because of Raja. And yet, which was the first party to say, we don't want you? It was the DMK. Even if the consequence of their not wanting us is that they didn't get a single seat in Tamil Nadu, they still left us. They preferred suicide to being the homicide that was going to come their way with the Congress Party. The TMC had left us. Who was with us? We were absolutely on our own. We had no BSP, we had no SP, we had no TMC. We didn't even have those dissident Muslims in Assam with us. I've forgotten the name of their party, All India, United Democratic Front or something they call it. He manufactures scents, you know, things that smell nice. The national conference was not with us. Who was with us? Nobody was with us. So the inherent strength of the Congress, which I suspect is about 140, 150, had collapsed owing to this, that we kept opening opportunities for others. And the proof of this lies in the fact that whatever the Modi way, they got only 32% of the vote. And if you take the states where they contested, that is, you leave out where they weren't present at all, even then they got only 38% of the vote. So had the remaining 62 or 68% got together as they did in 2004 and 2009, then the tea shops of India might be blossoming. The fact of the matter is that the BJP has won on a minority vote in a first-past-the-post system which gives advantages to the person who is at 40 love and advantage, which the person who is at 40 love and disadvantage doesn't have. And the defeat is palpable. I'm not trying to run down our defeat. We had never been at 44. At our worst, we were at approximately 3 times that figure. And at our best, we were at 10 times that figure. So to be at 44 is no cause for any kind of rejoicing. The Congress has been well and truly beaten. And there's a large number of states where we didn't win a single seat. Nothing in Andhra Pradesh, nothing in Tamil Nadu, nothing in Rajasthan, nothing in Gujarat, almost nothing even in Haryana, next to nothing in Uttar Pradesh, nothing at all in Bihar, nothing at all in West Bengal, and I think nothing at all in Kashmir as well. So, I don't rejoice in this position, please don't misunderstand me. But to expect me to sit down and start shedding tears is, I think, to be as unrealistic as for me to be joyous at having 44 seats. We are down, but we are not out. Now, how do we come back? There are simple solutions offered by those who do not have our interest at heart. The first and most important is to stop being a dynastic party. Are we a dynastic party? You take the case of Jawaharlal Nehru. He's the son of Motilal. That's why I begin the dynasty with him. His preferred candidate, lost the presidentship of the Congress in 1915. He himself, after the Nehru-Liaquat Pact was not approved of by the Congress Parliamentary Party, tried to resign from the Prime Minister. He had to face challenges, and then he had to face 3 elections. And then he had to face the reverses of the 1962 war. And if it had been a monarchy, he'd have lost his head on any one of these occasions. Because it's a democracy, he had to either win or lose. And while he was lucky that he died before he would have lost in 1967, the fact is that it was a life of political ups and downs, even as Prime Minister of India. Then came Indira Gandhi. That's nearer your time, so I don't need to repeat the story. But you know her ups and you know her downs. Come to Rajiv Gandhi. Right? He was nominated Prime Minister. But then he fought an election. And he got a larger majority than any Congress Prime Minister has ever done. And then he ended up, 5 years later, with less votes than any Congress Prime Minister has ever had. Or rather, less seats than the Congress Party has ever had. And what did he do? I remember the day that the voting was taking place, the counting was taking place, and it looked almost, it looked certain that the Congress would lose. And I was at a cocktail party where Yashwant Sinha was present. And Yashwant's a friend from his IAS days and my IAS days. So he took me to a corner and he said, something we want to tell you. I said, yes. He said, if Rajiv and Sonia want to go to Italy, we won't stand in the way. Go to Italy? What on earth makes you think they'll go to Italy? But that was the kind of illusion in which the opposition lived. By describing this as a dynasty instead of understanding that they are active politicians who are winning first the support of their party and then winning the support of the people. Then we had the period of Narasimha Rao. Now, I've always believed that Narasimha Rao was the first BJP Prime Minister of India. And my comment on him on the day after the Babri Masjid fell was that Narasimha Rao has proved that death is not a necessary precondition for rigor mortis to set in. The man did nothing at a moment of real crisis for secular India. He did nothing. And therefore was deservedly kicked out first by the people of India and then by the party. And the party was then handed over to a green trader from Dinapur called Sitaram Kesari, who was an unmitigated disaster. I walked out on him and became the national secretary of the Trinamool Congress, which I happened to form. 5 more minutes. I just started. I've only cleared my throat. But maybe we can get further answers done, in the question answer session. And then we had this amazing comeback. Don't forget that the smallest number of seats the Congress has ever won was under Sonia Gandhi in 1999. We got only 114 seats, if my memory is right. And who could then have predicted that poor little Sushma Swaraj would be able to keep her hair, her lustrous locks. I can't call her Goldilocks because her golden hair is not golden. Well, black locks. So proud of her hair, shave it off, as if it's a great sacrifice she's making to the country. And why even Italian becomes the Prime Minister? No Italian can become the Prime Minister of India. Only an Indian can. And anyone who says that someone born in Italy cannot be an Indian is a racist. I see no difference between them and Hitler. None. You're raising your eyebrows, therefore I'm emphasizing it. I see none. Anyone who regards an Indian as not an Indian by virtue of origin will have to contend with me because I'm a Pakistani by birth. I'm a refugee in your country. And if you say to me that there's no such thing as a Tamil Brahmin refugee from Pakistan, then sorry, I'm not an Indian. I'm an Indian. We're all Indians. And yet to talk in those terms, that vulgar language of 2004, I'm glad we're never going to hear that again. But she led the coalition that brought us to power. And then, incredible as it may sound, appointed Manmohan Singh, who so captured the fancy of this completely whimsical middle class of India, that he was the absolute darling whom you made the Prime Minister again. I didn't make him Prime Minister, you did. And today, I get a joke on my the mobile. Today, an SMS message saying that the only Sikh who has ever taken revenge for the Sikh riots of 1984 is Dr. Manmohan Singh, because he single-handedly wrecked the Congress. Now, these kind of jokes notwithstanding, the fact is that we lost all our allies and we came to the state to which we did. The answer doesn't lie in getting rid of the dynasty. The, for good reasons rather than bad, the Gandhi family is the bonding adhesive of the Congress Party. Every time we've not had them, we've started disintegrating. And my usual challenge to people who ask me, why don't you get rid of this dynasty, is to say, whom are you going to put in their place? Do you want Mallikarjun Kharge? Do you want Amarinder Singh? Do you want Ghulam Nabi Azad? Do you want Ahmed Patel? Do you want Father Oscar? Who am I going to put at the head? Mani Shankaraya? I guarantee the party will disintegrate by day after tomorrow. So we've chosen the Gandhis as our leader because we believe that they are the ones who could lead the party. What does leading mean? It means it's where the buck stops. It means that is where the questions end. In the case of the notorious case of P.V. Narasimha Rao, who said that not taking a decision is a decision, he didn't take any decisions because he knew that the minute he took a decision, immediately there would be dissidents led by Arjun Singh in the party. And ultimately that led to Arjun Singh forming the Tiwari Congress. So we need them. The opposition knows it, which is why they want to get rid of them. Because they are the single biggest stumbling block to the BJP or anybody, any other party becoming the natural party of governance. So long as the Congress stands united, until then it will be the natural party of governance. And how long will that be? So long as the Gandhis are at the top. Because then there's no quarrel at the top. And we spend all our time arguing over who is 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. But there's no argument over who is number one. And that's what imparts a dynamic of unity to the party, which is the fundamental prerequisite for any kind of comeback. So will we have a comeback? I don't know. Will we not have a comeback? I don't know. I think it is entirely possible that we will. It's faintly possible that we really screw it up. That's to be seen. But I think our people have been too long in politics, too long part of the history of India, too long an integral part of the governance of this country, to not be able to come up with an answer. And going by the past, it takes about 6 or 7 months after an electoral defeat for the leadership to decide what it can sell to the party. And at that point, some kind of a game plan is revealed. But any game plan has to be flexible at the edges so that we take account of evolving circumstances. And for me, the most hopeful evolving sign is the decline of Narendra Modi. Now, it's beautiful distinctions are being drawn between the BJP and Modi, between the RSS and the BJP, between the Sangh Parivar and the RSS, between Yogi Adityanath and Sakshat Maharaj, or what's his name, and Sakshat Maharaj and Uddhav Thackeray's gang, and between them and people who call themselves Bangaraj, Bajrang Bali or Bajrang Dali, and Naya Kodrani, the noble creatures. I mean, it sounds like somebody standing in court and saying, Sare Muslim ko le aao court mein. This is what that lot is. They can't get away from themselves. And the BJP is at heart got only one agenda, and that is Hindutva. Hindutva means Hindu Raj. And the opposite of Hindu Raj is secular Raj. So they'll drift in that direction. And why I think they'll be defeated is that Hindutva has nothing to do with Hinduism. And the Indian Hindu has repeatedly rejected the philosophy of Hindutva and the extremist advocates of Hindutva. And so, one day, someday, inshallah, sooner than later, we'll get our act together. Who knows? I may come back as a minister. Thank you.